Welcome to online worship for Broadway and Port Colden United Methodist Churches. My name is Pastor Catherine, and I greet you from wherever you are joining us from this day, the 22nd Sunday after Pentecost, October 29th, 2023, the last Sunday of the month, as we end our series looking at the beauty in giving. Considering that God desires for us to live lives of contentment and freedom from worry and joy in abundance, and considering how God has inspired us to live a generous life. I invite you to open yourself up to how God is moving and speaking this day, and may you be transformed by our time together. Will you join me now in our call to worship? The words will be on your screen. Your responses are in bold. We gather today hoping to be fed by God. Sometimes we worry that what we have is not enough. Jesus fed thousands with just 5 loaves and 2 fish. God will feed us today. Praise God. The little we have is enough for God to receive, bless, and multiply. God will provide enough for us and for others. Glory to God. Amen. Let us continue our time in song. Will you join me in a unison prayer? The words will again be on the screen. Let us pray together.
Faithful God, remind us today that everything, big and small, can be used to bless the community. Help us to remember that you can take what we have and multiply it to meet our needs. Increase our faith as we trust you for our provision. We recognize that we are better together than alone. You have called each of us to live in connection with each other. God, we give you thanks that as we love you, you give us the heart to love our neighbor. Today, we give you praise for all the ways you have blessed us in our personal lives, our church, and our community. Amen.
Growing up, one of my favorite moments was gathering in fellowship hall week after week for fellowship, for homemade treats. The sign-up list came out in the early fall, and my sister and I enjoyed every year choosing whether our family would host fellowship before or after our birthdays. Food was how we made connections and built relationships and created community. And looking back, I am in awe of just how much work went into those weekly Sunday gatherings. Now, growing up, our childhood pastor was a diabetic. It wasn't like publicly declared, but it was known well enough. And I remember for a long time, there would be a pack of very dry, sugar-free wafers that were placed among the homemade goodies week after week. And the kids were allowed to have them after they had been placed out and untouched for 3 weeks. Finally, someone had the thought to ask the pastor if this was even something that he had wanted, and he kindly shared, as he was apt to do, how he doesn't always get a chance to get downstairs, but he would prefer fruit if he had a choice in the matter. See, the fellowship team believed that the wafers were an act of hospitality. They made it easier for whoever was serving that day and gave an option for the minister, but it didn't actually include the wants of the person it was for. It didn't actually include other voices, and so it became a burden, an annoyance, instead of a blessing. After that conversation, new instructions came out inviting people to consider bringing something other than sweets when they hosted, suggesting small sandwiches and crackers and cheese and fruit. It was publicly announced, and all of a sudden, after these instructions, it seemed more people started staying for fellowship. Because by offering more inclusive options, by letting people know, more people felt welcomed into this time. Simple generosity, intentional generosity, trusting there is enough. Over these past few weeks, we have been invited to witness the beauty of giving among us, to consider what it looks like to be a true community of generosity, a community of good stewards where we are. And if we are honest, this is harder than it seems on the outset, because most people would say they're generous, but most generosity is conditional. Because if we are honest, that is what the world tells us, what it instills in us about generosity. You give something to get something. But what would happen? What could happen if we reject that ideal? How would the world blossom if small acts of generosity were peppered throughout daily life? Our scripture today from the Gospels is probably one we have heard before, and it goes like this. Jesus has been preaching and teaching, and after crossing over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, a huge crowd kept following him wherever he went because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. So Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with his disciples around him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?" He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good is that with this huge crowd?" "Tell everyone to sit down," said Jesus. So they all sat down on the grassy slopes, thousands of them. The men alone numbered about 5,000. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted. And after everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted." So they picked up the pieces, and they filled 12 baskets with scraps of bread left over. When the people saw him do this miraculous sign, they exclaimed, "Surely he is the prophet we have been expecting." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. See, this crowd who came from all over were sick and wanted healing. This crowd, they were tired of living under Roman occupation. This crowd, they were there because they were in need of something more and had heard about the amazing things Jesus had done. Yet Jesus knows this, but doesn't take them one by one and heal them. He doesn't preach a fiery message about challenging the systems. Jesus only seeks a way to feed them well. Philip is extremely practical, saying it would cost far too much to buy bread for all these people. Andrew notices a little boy's food, but is also justifiably skeptical about how little there is for such a large crowd. Can you imagine? Yet Jesus takes this humble and generous gift from this little boy, which did not seem like enough, and multiplies it to feed everyone and have leftovers. In this world, there is enough actual food to feed everybody. But the brokenness and narrowness of our human systems and structures prevent people from being fed. Food is wasted. In the church, in this church, we have enough, even with our very limited resources, but we have enough to create a welcoming and safe community. And so we must be willing to share our abundance in Christ with the world, regardless of what we may actually have. So I wonder, beloved, what are the barley loaves and fish that we have to give here? What does it mean to live in a way that reflects God's care for each other and all of creation? How is God calling us not to waste, but to use all that we have been given for the good of all? Today, as we consider these questions, we also pause to remember all the saints who have gone before us, those in this community and in our lives that have left their impact on us for better or for worse. This day is an opportunity to give thanks for their lives, to celebrate our history that they have been a part of, the traditions that still shape our community today. And in our sharing, in our remembering, we get to see how God has provided for us through the generosity and sacrifice of those who have come before us. The stories of the saints should be encouraging us to be all God has created us to be, people of generosity, a community of good stewards. And we are reminded through their stories and our remembering that though we may at times face scarcity, Jesus receives what we offer, blesses it, and provides for us and through us. Now, during our in-person worship, we will take some time together to share the examples of generosity we have encountered in our own lives. We will take time to consider what has been stirred up within us over these weeks as we have reflected on what it means to trust that there is enough. And I encourage you to take some time this week to consider the same, to consider the spaces of abundance where maybe you have only seen scarcity. But if nothing else this day, we consider together how we can honor the gifts of the whole community, those who are gathered in this place and gathered virtually. We commit that we must honor the gifts that we have in this place for the world to be transformed, for the kingdom of God to come. And so if nothing else, my loves, may we remember this day that our everyday decisions are an extension of the ministry and worship we do in this place. May we remember that we are conduits of blessing in the world. May we remember to give all we can where we are. May we remember that there is enough, because we serve a God of abundance. And God is faithful throughout the generations. Amen.
Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you let my love be shown? Will you let my name be known? Will you let my life be grown in you and you in me? Will you leave yourself behind if I but call your name? Will you care for cruel and kind and never be the same? Will you risk the hostile stare? Should your life attract or scare? Will you let me answer prayer in you and you in me? Will you let the blinded see if I but call your name? Will you set the prisoners free and never be the same? Will you kiss the leopard lid and do such as this unseen and admit to what I mean in you and you in me? Will you love the you you hide if I but call your name? Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use the faith you've earned to reshape the world around through my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me? Lord, your summons echoes true when you but call my name. Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you in me.
When I was in seminary, I remember a professor being questioned about this story that we heard, the feeding of the 5,000, about how real it was and how miraculous it was. And the professor said that some academics had argued that maybe Jesus didn't actually multiply the gifts, right? There wasn't a Mary Poppins keep on pulling and there's more kind of situation. Some academics believe that as the things were passed around, people reached into their own baskets, their own bags, their own whatever, and added to what was there. And so people were inspired through the selflessness of this little child to give what they had, the little they had that they thought was not enough to even offer. And so the classmate who asked this question was like, see, I knew it. Maybe Jesus doesn't do miracles. And the professor said, but wasn't that a miracle in itself to inspire a group of people to look beyond themselves? There is enough. Whether we try hard together, or whether God does something miraculous, there's always enough. There is always a way for good. So may we trust in the God of abundance May we be inspired to give all that we can. May we be content with whatever has been given to us, and may we be generous to give it back into the world. Go into this day and into this week and into this world, inspired by our God of generosity, inspired by the abundance that dwells among us. And may the world be changed because you have chosen to look beyond yourself. So go, and may the God of hope, the God of love, the God of peace, and the God of abundance go with you in all that you do. Amen.